Every day, we send our kids off to school, hoping that the heavy doors, the resource officers, and the school staff will be enough to keep our kids safe. However, the Uvalde school shooting left a lot of unanswered questions and exposed glaring holes in most school safety plans. Today, I will be discussing this with two educators and the students, and we will keep open minds and try to figure out how to keep our schools safe. This is the Big Bang Theory.
All right.
Foreign lands, I laid my sword in the sand. I made my peace with man. They lay by the beast as far as my eyes can see. I seek a golden fleece. One day you'll make your peace. So don't tempt my hand. I'm just a man, a deadly scene, a weathered beam. Men must cry with soldiers loud, threaten land. My guns go bang. I can make the guns go bang. I make all the guns go bang. I can make the guns go bang. I make all the guns go bang.
Welcome back. We're here today with some educators and a student, and we're going to talk about violence in schools, gun violence, and the recent mass shootings that we've had here. So I want to introduce to you my wife, Shay, my daughter, Shiloh, and my sister-in-law, Lisa. Shay and Lisa are both educators, and Shiloh will be our designated student for today. She will be talking a little bit from the student side of all of this. So it's real good to have you ladies. The first question I want to ask you about is, what gun laws, if any, do you think will really help prevent mass shootings in general? Not even just in schools, but like the one that we had at the grocery center, the ones that we've seen in malls recently and things like that. What do you think are some gun laws that can be passed that will actually make a difference in these type of events?
Well, that is an interesting question. And I think that it's going to be tough to find solutions when the world is so bipartisan, when there's so many that are so far on either side. I would like to see more security measures taken in schools. Specifically,
more security on foot on campus,
right? People as well as actual tangible things, like the doors should be locked. Like there should be, you know, potentially I saw on one show where they were talking about where if they had like the fences that drop down.
I don't want to cut you off here, Shay, but we are going to get into that a little later in the segment. I don't want to, you know, give anything away just yet.
Okay.
But I do just want to talk about the measures we can put in place right now, or if you believe there are measures that we can put in place as far as gun control.
Specifically gun control.
Right.
There is a lot of talk about banning weapons. I don't think a ban necessarily will do any good. Me personally, just like with a, you know, different types of driver's license, you have to be specially trained to drive a big truck. You should be specially trained to have the big guns. A graduated licensing system of some type, I think, would be beneficial.
Okay.
I definitely think you should be looking at the age of 18 as being not necessarily being a starting point to where you do have that accessibility. I will say that I get where there could be, some people might differ with that. If you have military individuals, they are able to have weapons and they only have to be 18. So I could see why there would be an argument there for that. I know some may say that they don't necessarily get deep and in-depth training, but I still think there's something with service, something with honor, duty, that sort of makes it separate than the general public being able to do it at 18. So maybe that 21 time frame is better. If you can't drink alcohol at 18, I don't really see why you should be able to carry a gun.
So, Lisa, you were saying something about a licensing system. Could you go a little bit more into detail about how you think that would work?
I think it should be something along the lines of the more just training hours with weapons, self-defense, just handling of the weapons. I'm not a gun enthusiast per se, but I know some guns handle differently than others. I've shot a few of them. I know this from experience. So just hours of training. Once you get so many hours, you have satisfactorily completed, you know, this license.
So say for like your handgun.
For your handgun.
So now you can carry a handgun because say you have 15 hours under your belt.
Exactly.
Another 25 hours, then you can, you know, perform, you can go out and buy an AR-15.
Exactly.
So something along those lines. That's not a terrible idea. I mean, you're probably going to get a lot of pushback.
There's
going
to be pushback with any type of
and that is true.
Gun control law. So you have to start somewhere. You can't just not do anything and just stand by and be complacent with the whole situation.
But that's it. I am not a person who's like, I don't think either guns kill people, you know, I'm not one of those people that think that, but I'm also not a person that thinks that it doesn't have something to do with it. There has to be some sort of balance, and you have to be able to acknowledge that you can make common sense laws that are going to affect the bad guys and not necessarily the good guys, because I do understand that a lot of the laws that have been put forth, or the ideals for laws that have been put forth for gun control, will really only affect law-abiding, reasonable gun owners. And if that is the case, you're not doing or serving the purpose of what we're trying to do.
And that with the licensing system, it's not taking anything away from anybody who wants a gun.
Right.
You have to know how to operate it, how to be safe with it, stuff like that. So.
Yep, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I get that. That's not a terrible idea. Let's go back to what you were saying, Shay, about the military. As far as the military personnel that joins at 18, and if they want to buy an AR-15, that's perfectly fine because they're going to get said many hours of training.
Right.
Versus the civilian who may or may not have that amount of training going in. I can't speak for the typical civilian, but as you know, our boys, before they went to the military, actually had a lot of training with the AR-15, learned and was very familiar with it before going in, and was able to break it down, reassemble it, and fire with accuracy. Not saying that that's the case for everybody, but what about the people out there that are going to say, well, I train harder, I train more, I put in more hours with my rifle than, say, you know, the guys that go through basic training or only gets, you know, a week or two of basic marksmanship. Why can't I own a rifle and they can at 18?
And that's fair. I would say a few things. Number one, none of this is going to be a perfect science. None of this is going to be 100% effective. There's nothing that is. But first, your frontal lobe isn't even fully developed. So you've got that working against you when you were a younger person. And a person that wants to get a driver's license, they could put in all the hours they want at 13, 14, and 15. They still can't get that license until they're 16. And there's nothing wrong with having to wait to a certain landmark to be able to do something. I don't think that that should prohibit a law from being made, because there are a few that may train harder for it. And they'll just be even that much more prepared when they do get to that age.
Yeah, that's not a bad thing to have to wait.
Yeah, and with entitlement and the way it's going, it is not a bad thing for somebody to have to wait for something.
Mm-hmm. All right. Good answers. All right, Shiloh, we're going to come back over to you. I wanted you to tell us a little bit about yourself, what grade you're in. Don't tell us what school you go to. Just what grade you're in. And then I want you to explain to us what it's like going through one of these active shooter drills. What are you expected to do? Again, without giving away the entire plan, we don't want to give any of these guys any ideas or any more information they have, but keep it real basic. Let us know what you go through, how you're feeling when you're going through these active shooter drills. So what do you have to say about that, Shy?
Hi, I'm Shiloh. I'm 12 years old and I'm going to 7th grade in the fall. I feel that the drills in the schools I used to go to or do go to that they have now are not good drills in my opinion.
Okay, so this is for all your former schools, including the one that you're currently attending now,
yes.
Right? What do you think is bad about those drills?
Well, the drills that they have us doing for an intruder, so we go across the wall, we kind of just stand there, and the shooter would walk in, and if they just so happen to turn to the right side, they're gonna see us, and you know that.
Okay, so basically, your drill is kind of getting you out of the line of fire.
Out of the line of fire.
So if they're looking through the door, they can't see you directly, right?
Yeah.
Okay, but like you were saying, if they come into the classroom and look to the right, you guys are all lined up there.
Yeah.
Okay, so what do you think, in your opinion, just from what you've seen, would be a better idea to keep people safe just in the classroom setting?
Well, if a shooter is in, we should be able to like barricade the door, maybe put some desks and chairs there, and if we have a window there, we should have a window. We should be able to go out the window and leave that area immediately.
Now, that's a really good point, though, that you had. Barricading the door, you don't do any of the barricading of the doors type thing? Huh, that's interesting. And that's a really good idea. Like, any type of time-adding mechanisms that you can add to stop the shooter from getting into the classroom, that helps. That buys time. They don't really like to stick around and fight to have to get into a classroom. They're going to move on to an easy target 9 times out of 10. We've seen it in the past. Studies have shown this. So what you're saying is actually a really good idea. As far as getting out, also a great idea. I understand why the school wouldn't want to say that so much, because you don't know where the active shooter is.
But yeah, they're probably concerned too about if they go out, then where are they going to?
Where are they going? And once they're out of the classroom, what kind of chaos with the students being scared?
Right.
And
then
all this?
If the shooter then comes out, now is it now? Like, there are complications that could arise from that too, but
common
if
sense
you
tells
make
you
a
if
plan,
you're in a dangerous area,
yeah,
you
should
leave the dangerous area.
Okay, wait, hold on. I'm gonna introduce you guys. You guys have moved on. Great topic, great dialogue we have going here. But Shay, what your grade that you teach? Tell us a little bit about it.
Middle school level.
Okay.
In Florida.
Awesome. Okay. So you guys were saying, like, if you all rush outside, there's going to be a lot of confusion. You may not even know who the shooter is. We've seen in the past, like, I believe it was Parkland, where the shooter was actually able to blend in with the students that were being evacuated. But I want to ask this about the escaping part of that. In a fire drill, don't we run from the fire?
Absolutely.
Right. So, I mean, it has to be a safer way to map out your escape route.
Well, that's what I was going to say. That if you have a plan and you structure it, then it makes more sense. But since currently the plan is to hide, in essence, hide, and you're not, you don't have a plan.
Hide at times in classrooms that are full of windows.
Yes.
And there's not really a blind corner to hide in, and we have classrooms sometimes 30 students in them,
right?
So it's hard to corral 30 students into one corner that's still visible through,
right? You're not even all in the corner, you're still visible.
Okay, and Lisa, that's you over there. Tell us a little bit about you, what grade you teach.
I currently teach 4th grade at an elementary school in Florida. I personally taught in a portable the last couple years that had windows on 3 sides of the portable. And the safe corner that they designated for us to go to was right across from a window. Another corner was right across from a window. The other corner was the corner with a window. So,
that's a totally unique situation as well. That's totally different than being inside a building in a classroom, because like you said, there's really no place where you're off of line of sight. On top of that, the portables aren't really thick material. If you have someone who is really out of their mind and looking to cause damage, they don't even have to come in there. They can shoot from the outside of the portables. Mm-hmm. What about curtains in your portables? Do they have something that you can draw?
We have blinds that a lot of the time are broke and don't close and have gaps in them.
That seems like an even scarier situation than in the classrooms. And that's something that I haven't even thought of yet, and how to react in those situations. I guess in some situations it's good for those guys in the portable if the shooter is on the inside versus inside of the school versus the outside of the portables. It gives you guys
where
a more...
Where they can easily jump a fence that's not high. Like, you can climb over the fence easily. What do you call it? Box wire cutters, just cutting the chain off the fence.
Yeah. And there's
my classroom, along with 15 other portable classrooms, were easily accessible.
Wow.
To me, the easiest to get to. If you know they're there, you know, you're gonna, it's a soft target.
Like you said, you're gonna go for the easiest target.
If you don't know they're there, because, you know, they're kind of tucked off, then that's, but most people would probably know they're there. Mm-hmm. And especially if you, you know, get into the fact of who typically is committing a lot of the shootings, and you're talking about the school setting, if it's going to be a student,
students
they're
from
gonna
that
know.
School, they're going to know.
Right.
Yeah, and that does put you at a disadvantage as well, because if they start at the portables, the people in the school may not even know what's happening.
Yeah, my portable, third grade portables, fifth grade portables were all out in a field.
Wow.
Almost. So.
Yeah, so you can miss those initial gunshots, mm-hmm. and then he makes his way to the school to cause even more damage.
And really, once where my classroom was, once you're in that fence, like you can get anywhere.
You can get into the school
really
without
being,
any deterrent.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because any type of anything, it's all on the outside. So once you get into the gate, it's open season. It doesn't like stop from segment to section.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha.
Once you're inside that.
We won't say too much more about that, because that again is one of those security things. And as I'm listening to it, that's horrible. There's got to be ways that we can tighten that up. Just little things. The next section that we're going to move into is going to be resource officers.